This movie seems to have slipped under people's critical radar and gets labeled as a turn-off-your-brain action comedy that's an homage to the Roger Moore James Bonds of old. And I went into it hoping to enjoy it on that level. But the very first shot pulled me out of it. And from there, it all fell apart. The movie starts with a shot of a tape playing. I buy that. They were still around in 97. But what's with the song?
I don't think the Dire Straits were big in the Middle East a decade after they were popular in the US.
And the guys in the helicopter are probably listening to Pantera or something. I'm 40, and this song came out when I was 8. So you aren't really shooting for a very young demo. It has nothing to do with the scene, or anyone in the scene. It's not really for the audience. Why is this in here? It reminded me a little bit of the Kevin Smith story about writing the treatment for Superman Reborn.
Well, you know what? We're going to give a shot at it. And I said, all right, awesome. And he goes, it's pending approval of the producer. And I said, who's the producer? And they said, John Peters. I said, all right, what do I got to do? They're like, you got to go meet with him. I said, okay. He's like, I got some directives for you. If you're going to move forward on the process, some things I want you to do and don't in the script. He's going, three things. Okay. I said, all right. He's going, one, I don't want to see him in that suit. Two, I don't want to see him fly. And three, he's got to fight a giant spider in the third act. So they turn around, they tell me, like, Kevin, we're kind of done. Tim wants to go another way with a new writer. And I was like, all right. You know, and I wasn't really that upset. I didn't feel, because I'd worked on it for two drafts, and I got to hang out with a really fucked up kooky dude the next summer when I went to the movies and saw a movie that John Peters had produced. And it was called The Wild Wild West. So I'm sitting in the theater watching the movie. I'm like, good Lord, this is a piece of shit. But then all of a sudden, like a giant fucking spider shows up.
Well, I think the development meeting went something like this.
You know the problem with Apocalypse Now and the first scene when they're moving in with the helicopter? They're playing that classical pussy shit while they're doing it. What I want to hear is, I want my MTV.
Right!
Yeah!
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 My point is, I think this movie has a little bit of teenage wish fulfillment by director Matthew Vaughn. This song isn't nearly as egregious as the giant mechanical spider, but it pulled me out of the scene. But the Rolling Rubble titles look like they're CGI from 1997, so at least they're period accurate. The Kingsmen do a crappy job searching a subject they plan to interrogate. I don't know how you'd miss a mouth-accessible grenade when tying someone to a chair, but fine. Something has to kill Eggsy's dad heroically to start this movie. I guess it's refreshing to see the downside from the beginning, that they're capable of making big, stupid mistakes, and that they have a weird, creepy, death-based hierarchy.
Welcome to Kingsmen.
Then we get an odd scene where Colin Firth gives young Eggsy his father's gold watch. I mean, get out of jail free necklace MacGuffin he will use later. Then we have what seems like a passing of the torch, or the scotch in this case, as the smug James Bond avatar with a hearing problem is sliced in half by a deadlier female Oscar Pistorius. Haha, girl power. But wait, she's dressed like a maid. Now she's bringing down sheets? And covering the dead bodies? In service of Sam Jackson, who's doing an annoying Steve Urkel meets Russell Simmons affect he frequently forgets about throughout the movie. Okay.
No stomach for violence. I mean, literally, I see one drop of blood, that is me done. I'm like, projectile. Listen, I'm so sorry you had to witness all this unpleasantness due to our uninvited guests.
And he's different from other bad guys. He's smiling and dorky. He hates the sight of blood. And he's super polite to his fellow Jedi. He's not your father's Bond villain. Then we have your standard, this world is changing conversation between Colin Firth and Michael Caine.
The world is changing.
Where he intimates the royals are inbred and close-minded about lower class white people. So in an effort to prove Michael Caine wrong, he hires Eggsy when he uses the get-out-of-jail-free necklace MacGuffin from earlier, after stealing and crashing a car, because he's got Kingsman midichlorians from his father? Colin Firth, claiming to be repaying a life debt he owes to Eggsy's father, No, no, different movie. He details the surveillance he's evidently been doing on Eggsy for years, and Eggsy is rightfully upset. This is the one conversation in the entire movie that feels authentic. We have the struggle between classes clearly spelled out, and it's the first and last time this movie will address any of these issues. Colin Firth has to fight with the guys that have a very good reason to kick Eggsy's ass, because...
If you're looking for another rent boy, they're on the corner of Smith Street.
They intimate he's gay? Way to set the example, deadly Secret Service guy. You kicked those 20-somethings' ass. This is played off as heroic, not wildly unnecessary, and frankly stupid. He's blowing his cover in hopes of impressing a 25-year-old. Did Colin Firth replace Kevin Spacey in this movie? So when Eggsy inexplicably returns home, his stepdad wants to kill him because he's gotten all his men beaten up. But Colin Firth has bugged Eggsy and threatens to expose his stepfather's criminal activity unless he lets him go. So he's basically ruined what's left of Eggsy's life, prejudged him without thinking of his circumstances, and monitored his conversations without telling him. What a great mentor. We love you, big brother. Eggsy parkours his way out of there, goes to meet his older gentleman friend, who takes him into a small dressing room, stares at him in a mirror, and compares his situation to Pretty Woman.
Did you see the film Trading Places?
No.
How about Nikita? Pretty Woman? All right.
Nothing weird about this at all. Then we have a stupid BS exposition dump sequence as we and Eggsy descend into stupidity. Because Eggsy isn't a Kingsman yet. He's to now go through the MI6 Hunger Games portion of the movie, where Eggsy must face off against the children of rich people? Really? Not the cream of the crop from other military branches, but the children of rich people? Because there's nothing I want more than Beavis and Butthead here looking out for our national security. Come to think of it, the one on the left kind of looks like Eric. This is problematic on many levels, but most importantly when it comes to oversight, specifically civilian oversight of our Secret Service, or CIA. Our Congress does a really bad job of it. So when you take a group that already seemingly have unchecked powers, with questionable oversight, and you make them our social betters, you reinforce the notion that these people can't be questioned or held accountable for their actions. Besides, rich kids should be left to dispense justice in their own way by revealing their parents' tax evasion on Instagram. Thanks for doing what the IRS won't, rich kids. Keep up the good work. So, the CIA scorch trials go on for 40 fucking minutes and consist of some of the stupidest tests that wouldn't prepare them in the least for the job they're going to face. The take-home lesson is, basically, Mark Strong is a lying asshole. Mark Hamill's head explodes. Then we're introduced to Tildy, the Scandinavian princess, who seems to be the only assertive female character. She stands up to Sam Jackson and tells him how crazy his plan is.
You are completely crazy.
När gäller statsministern, chockad över att du överhuvudtaget överväger det här. Du är vald av folket. Det är ditt jobb.
Sorry, your royal highness.
And is thrown in prison because she refuses to cooperate. At about the halfway point, when Firth and Jackson meet, that's when the movie's style completely falls apart. It gives up on its own narrative and goes from somewhat cleverly subverting Bond tropes to beating you over the head with this fourth wall breaking conversation about their specific Bond character's archetype. But it all starts with the gratuitous McDonald's product placement. It might have been funny if they hadn't talked about it, if Sam Jackson hadn't remarked how well it went with a 45 Lafitte, or if the food wasn't prominently featured through the whole scene in the fucking two shot. We get it, movie. You're not our father's James Bond. You eat crap food with expensive drinks. You have subverted our expectations by being bigger sellouts to shittier brands. Although this scene does summarize this movie perfectly, high-end, intoxicating action, but content-wise, it's shitty McDonald's served on a silver platter. After this, they just give up altogether and start taking alternate sentences of Matthew Vaughn's interior monologue about the James Bond series.
Nowadays, they're all a little serious for my taste. The old ones. Marvelous.
Give me a far-fetched theatrical plot any day.
The old Bond movies. Oh, man. Oh, when I was a kid, that was my dream job. Gentleman spy.
I always felt the old Bond films were only as good as the villain. As a child, I rather fancied a future as a colorful megalomaniac.
What a shame we both had to grow up.
Then the stupid Ender's Game asshole initiation continues, and English James Franco is eliminated.
Fucking Dad's gonna hear about this!
Then we come to the scene where Michael Caine demolishes what's left of the fourth wall and poops on it.
Pretty dog. What's his name?
JB.
As in James Bond?
No.
Jason Bourne?
No. Jack Bauer?
Oh! Bravo.
Then he tells him to...
shoot the dog.
I saw this coming, but seriously, fuck you, movie. This is dumb. Almost too dumb for this movie.
Give me the gun. At least the girl's got balls.
But hey, why not make blind, heartless obedience a manly trait, then apply it to a woman to emasculate a man? Girl power? So after being emasculated by Michael Caine, big brother Colin Firth decides to emasculate him again by taking control of his boss's car that also happens to be a taxi for no specific reason, so he can take Exit and show him his dead dog that he had stuffed and put over his toilet. This is just gross. And all this just for the shock and fake-out value? A picture wouldn't suffice? You had to make Firth look more like a psycho? Over the guilty felt over shooting a blank at his dog 12 years previous? Really? This fucker kills and tortures with impunity, but this really bothers him. So it really wasn't a test of loyalty at all. They just did it to drive home the central message of this movie. The Kingsmen are lying dicks. And Colin Firth has convinced himself he's destroyed Eggsy's life to repay his life debt, not just to win his Trading Places bet with Michael Caine. Then Colin Firth goes to the hardcore whackjob Christian church and makes a funny.
Where are you going? Hey, what's your problem?
I'm a Catholic whore, currently enjoying Congress out of wedlock with my black Jewish boyfriend who works in a military abortion clinic. So hail Satan. And have a lovely afternoon, madam.
You tell that hillbilly, you government-sponsored killing machine. Then the church fight happens, which is well choreographed, and they killed more people during Freebird than any other movie. Some movies couldn't even kill one person during Freebird. I'm looking at you, Forrest Gump. And we're back to fourth wall breaking Bond movie trope subverting dialogue. Oh joy.
You know what this is like? It's like those old movies we both love. Now I'm gonna tell you my whole plan, and then I'm gonna come up with some absurd and convoluted way to kill you, and you'll find an equally convoluted way to escape.
Sounds good to me.
Well, this ain't that kind of movie.
Thank God. I mean, no, I think thank God is right. Firth has been a loathsome character that we're supposed to like for no discernible reason other than he's Colin Firth. He hasn't grown or changed. He's been a pretty crappy agent. He's ruined Eggsy's life. Is this sad, really? Does Matthew Vaughn think stuffed dead dogs are motivational, not just gross? How much time is left in this piece of 40 minutes? Jesus Christ! Then Michael Caine dies because Eggsy puts the Ioking powder in both of their drinks, having built up an immunity. Sam Jackson reveals himself as a pro-eugenics authoritarian with a penchant for extreme population control.
Mankind is the virus. We're making our planet sick. A cull is our only hope. If we don't reduce our population ourselves, there's only one of two ways this can go. The host kills the virus, or the virus kills the host.
But give Sam Jackson credit, he knows how to get the crowd hyped.
What the fuck is wrong with you people?
Works every time. Then he convinces them genocide is cool because they're Jewish?
You are the chosen people.
No, wait, they're Noah.
When folk tell their kids the story of Noah's Ark, is Noah the bad guy? No. Is God the bad guy?
No. Even though God caused the flood? Boy, this is some stupid, non-motivating, motivational speechifying, even for this movie. Eggsy calls Brooks, who's floating in the upper atmosphere, suspended by what looks like upside-down silver testicles. He asks her if she's gotten her suit yet, because I'm sure she can't wait to look like a female Chris Hayes. Eggsy goes to Sam Jackson's genocide celebration gala and orders a drink.
Martini. Gin, not vodka, obviously. Stirred for 10 seconds while glancing at an unopened bottle of vermouth. Thank you.
Do you get it yet? We're subverting Bond tropes. This is not your father's James Bond. Eggsy has to fight everyone. Then because of this movie's dedication to being a low-rent, crasser version of Bond, where subtlety and subtext are the enemy, the movie decides to self-immolate while simultaneously destroying the one female character who has stood up to the bad guy the entire movie.
Sorry, love. Gotta save the world.
If you save the world, we can do it in the asshole.
I'll be right back.
Good luck!
I'll be right back.
You know the problem with Star Wars, when Princess Leia's in prison, there's no explicit promise of anal to get her out, am I right? Oh, filthy!
Bloody wanker!
It's Richard! Oh, I'm sorry, mate, I'm so smashed off this beer. But that's ginger beer! Look! Giant mechanical spider!
This completely ruins the movie for me. And the worst part is, it is completely unnecessary. It adds another level of sleaze to this movie that it did not need. It's not in the source material, this is all Matthew Vaughn, who said in an interview, it's a celebration of women and the woman being empowered in a weird way. Yes, Matt, in a weird, non-existent way. So the movie ends with heads exploding and Eggsy getting with Princess Tildy. Because taking advantage of emotionally vulnerable kidnapping victims is the Kingsman's way. And don't forget the gratuitous ass shot to empower Princess Tildy by making her Eggsy's sex trophy. Yay, girl power. This is followed by credits, then a mid-credit sequence where Eggsy goes back to the pub again. This time his stepfather and mother are there, along with his hooligans who I assume live upstairs. Eggsy knocks out his stepfather with a pint glass and prepares to fight the hooligans, whom I almost feel sorry for at this point. Cut to black, the end, thank God. But wait, there's a dedication. In loving memory of my mother, Kathy, who always put the extra into ordinary and taught me what a Kingsman should be. Two things about this. First, I'm sorry for your loss. Second, if you really thought that Princess Tildy scene at the end was empowering, why didn't you put the dedication to your mother right after it? After all, you said she taught you what a Kingsman should be. Why wouldn't you put that after the female empowering scene at the end? I'm curious if the bar confrontation scene was created after the fact. You know, where Eggsy defends his mother's honor because he had to make Eggsy do something noble before he put in that dedication? Vaughn or someone around him had the common sense to put credits and a mid-credit sequence between the princess ending and that dedication. Matthew Vaughn managed to reimagine James Bond and make it more elitist and white male-centric than it was already, incorporate more low-rent product placement than an Adam Sandler movie, and seems to think women are either subservient killing machines or sex trophies. So be wary of anything that tells you you have to turn off your brain to enjoy it. There's so many great movies and TV shows out there. Why not watch something that nourishes and engages your brain?
Little girl likes her brain. What's your opinion?
Damn you, Brockman!